I work in the area of theoretical computer science, and today I'll talk about an area called online algorithms. So I'll briefly describe what these are, and again I'll talk about the work we have been doing towards what are called packing and covering problems. Again, it's a very large class of problems. We'll try to give you some feel of what these kind of problems are. I should say that this is joint work with several colleagues at Carnegie Mellon University, Microsoft India, and Duke, and several of these students at IIT Delhi. Okay, so this is the brief outline. I'll briefly explain what online algorithms are and how we analyze them, and just talk about two applications, and then just conclude. So let me begin by just quickly describing to you, just give a two-slide introduction to what an online algorithm is. So online, what we have seen very often, you know, you often go online, buy something or things like that. But in the context of sort of algorithms, online basically means that you don't know everything in the future. Okay, so the input that you're going to see kind of arrives over future. Okay, so this is in contrast to what is called offline, where people say that, you know, the entire data is given to you upfront and you can do whatever you want with it. But here, the data sort of arrives over time. Okay, so that's what the word online means. So for example, this could be an algorithm, and this input arrives and it does something to it, produces some solution. And some more input arrives, and then the algorithm sort of augments the solution in some manner. Some more input arrives and keeps on changing, and so on. Okay, so that's the model. So let me give you the, you know, the first algorithm that people study here. It's called umbrella rental problem, or in literature it's called ski rental, but I'll call it umbrella rental. It's more relevant for us. So the model, the problem is very simple to state, but it kind of motivates a lot of the sort of problems that arise in this area. And so the basic model is like this. Let's say, you know, buying an umbrella costs 10 rupees, okay? And however, you can also, you also have the option of renting the umbrella, okay? So you can rent an umbrella for rupees 1 per day, okay? And the assumption is that it's going to rain for a couple of days. Let's say it's going to rain for n days, and from then onwards it will not rain, okay? And my problem is that, am I going to buy the umbrella or just keep on renting it for you for a few days? Okay. As you can imagine, it's a very basic problem which arises in many settings. And so the question is, are you going to rent or buy? And of course, it's a trivial problem if you kind of knew the future. If you knew the future, you would say that if it's going to rain for 5 days, I'm better off just renting it. If it's going to rain for 15 days, I should just buy it right away. Okay. So if you knew the future, it's a trivial problem. But you know, the only reason why it becomes interesting is because you don't know the future, and you know, it's a decision that you have to take every day. Okay, so yeah, okay. So somebody who knows the future is called an offline algorithm. So of course, we are in a setting where we don't know the future. Okay. So for example, you know, this could be a realistic situation that on day one you decide to rent and it rains. You're happy. Again, it rains. You rent. Okay, and you keep on renting. On day four, you decide to, okay, I have had enough. I'll just buy the umbrella. Right. And now it depends what happens in the future. Let's say on the sixth day it is sunny, then you know, you end up making a loss. What is the loss? Well, the loss is that you end up paying sort of 13 rupees of money, whereas somebody who knew the future could have just paid 10 rupees of money. Okay? So so an online algorithm, you can think of it as some sort of strategy which decides, you know, what to do at every step without knowing what the future would be. Okay? And the way we measure these things in the algorithms community is what is called a comparative ratio. Okay, so it's a ratio, think of it as a ratio of, you know, the fact that the algorithm, the your own strategy which doesn't know the future, how much sort of money it pays with respect to somebody who knew the entire future. Okay, so in, for example, in this setting the ratio would be 1.3. Okay, because you are paying 13 rupees, somebody who knew the future would have paid 10 rupees. Okay, so this ratio will always be more than one. Okay, and the closer it is to one, you feel that the better you are. Okay, and okay, so what is the optimal strategy? What's the best thing you can do? So one very natural strategy would be that because it costs 10 rupees, what I will do is that I'll rent for 10 days. Okay, and then I'll buy it. Okay, so okay, and you can show that, I will not prove it, but you can show that this will never be more than, you know, the ratio will never be more than 2, in the sense that no matter what happens, this strategy will always have the property that you will never pay more than 2, okay? And so you see, what people will say that this has comparative ratio of 2. Another way of saying this is that you are paying 50% more than, or sorry, 100% more than somebody who knew what the future is. Okay? And then people have all kinds of models here. You can enrich this model. You can say that, what if I was allowed to toss coins? Can I reduce this number to? Okay? Turns out that if you're allowed to toss coins, on average, you can do much better than 2. Okay? And then there are more complex models, which I will not go into. Okay? So that's a brief introduction to this. So all I basically said was, you know, this notion of comparative ratio, which kind of measures the fact that you are not knowing the future with respect to somebody who knows the entire input. There is a computational aspect to it as well, but I will not go into that part as such. Okay? So let me, with that brief introduction, just talk about the first problem. It's called bin packing. Okay? So the bin packing problem is very easy to define. And again, it's a very sort of widely used problem and one of the most commonly studied problems in theoretical computer science. So the problem goes like this. You are given a lot of bins, okay? And each bin has a fixed size. Think of it L as the size of the bin, okay? And what happens is that at each time, one object arrives, okay? It has some size. And you just have to pack these objects in these bins, okay? But you're not allowed to exceed the capacity of any of these bins, okay? So, and the goal is to use as few bins as possible. And again, you can imagine why this has so many applications. You can think directly of applications where you're trying to pack things into tracks or boxes. But also in more sort of virtual settings where you're trying to pack, you know, processes into computers, or you know, you have some sort of processing power and you don't want to overload things and so on and so forth. Okay? All right, so let's say the first object arrives, you place it in this bin, second object you place it here, third object you place it here, and so on. But the idea is that you don't have the complete picture of the set of objects that you will see. Okay? So you keep on packing them in bins as you know, as more things arrive. Okay? So why is this such an important problem? Well, first of all, it's a central problem in theoretical computer science. It has been studied since 1940s, simply because it has a huge number of applications. What is also interesting is that you know, many algorithmic ideas were first applied to this problem. Turns out that it still is an active area of research, and many new ideas have come from this problem. Okay, so there are traditional areas where it has been applied. For example, cutting stock problem is used a lot in paper industry. Disk allocation, you can imagine that in computers, you're trying to pack things into some sort of storage. Job scheduling, where you're trying to process a lot of data over a limited number of servers, and how do you pack them? So anywhere you're trying to pack things into a limited number of resources, you will meet some version of this problem. Okay, you can I showed you this is sort of a single dimensional versions. People have looked at you know squares and rectangles and boxes and you know higher dimensional objects, and all of these have a lot of interesting applications. And even the problem which I'm not going to talk about as such, but the setting where even I gave you the set of entire objects, even that is very interesting. And a lot of challenges remain there. Okay, so let me just mention the most natural thing that anybody will do. It's called the first fit algorithm. First fit algorithm says that whenever an item comes, do the most natural thing, just pack it in the first available bin. Okay, so let's say this yellow item comes, you pack it here, the next green item comes, it cannot fit in the first bin, so you put it in the second bin, this one goes back to the first bin, this can fit in the first bin, this can fit in the second bin, but not in the first bin, and so on. Okay. And let me just give you an and this would be, you know, this would seem like the most natural thing, but turns out that this is not optimal. Okay, somebody who knew the future can do much better. So let me tell you why this is the case. Okay, again a very simple example. So let's say, you know, initially a lot of very tiny items arrive. So you say that fine, I'll just keep on packing them in the first bin. And then again a lot of small items arrive, so you again pack them in the second bin. And then two slightly large items arrive. Okay, slightly more than half the capacity of this bin. Okay, so think of the capacity as 1. So half plus epsilon, half plus epsilon. Okay, and so you have used of 4 bins. But somebody who kind of knew the future would have packed them into 3 bins. Okay, so the fact that you don't know the future, you incur a loss of about, you know, 4 by, you know, the loss is like 4 by 3. That's the competitive ratio here. Okay, all right, so given this background, what all can we prove? So what in the 70s, it was shown that this algorithm is 1.7 competitive, the first fit algorithm, okay? Which basically means that you're paying 70% more than somebody who knew the entire future, okay? And then it was revised. Some more versions came of this algorithm, which were more complex, came to 1.66. Then something called harmonic algorithm, which is very widely used. It's 1.69. You can see it's a very slight improvement over these numbers, okay? But each of these improvements required many new ideas. Okay? So, and this algorithm was basically saying that, you know, if you go back to that example that I showed, it was very aggressive in packing the first few bins. So it said that you don't have to be very aggressive. You should, you know, leave out some large space in some of the bins. Okay. So I'll come back to this idea. And so turns out that you can do slightly better. Then came some more versions, some more very complex algorithms, you know, 40 parameters that you have to set in those. And you could improve this constant 1.7 to 1.588, which basically means that doing not as bad as 70%, but 58%. But improving these numbers has become quite a challenge. You know, currently I think it's somewhere, state of the art is somewhere, third digit, there's some improvement. There's a lower bound which says that no matter what you do, you can never beat 54%, okay? You cannot be better than 1.54, okay? So this is where the state of the art is, okay? And, okay. So let me talk about some of the problems that we have been working on in this domain. So what we have done is, what is natural is to add some more richer sort of elements in this model. So what we have done is we have added two new twists. One is that items can go away also, okay? So what that means is that as they arrive at some point, they will just finish and they'll just go away. And again, it's very natural in modern settings where, you know, you process something and then it goes away, okay? And so, you know, at some point, let's say this goes away, and so on. So situation can look like this. Okay, and if you are in this setting, it's very natural to see that you are doing very poorly here. You know, I could have fit everything in one bin, but just because this is how you had packed, this is how the situation looks like at some point. Okay, so what I will also allow you is that I will allow you to repack some of these items. Okay, so this is something that was not allowed earlier. If you could repack, then you can take out everything and pack everything back. So if I'm allowing you to repack, it looks like some sort of cheating here. Okay. But however, what you want to understand is what's the trade-off between these things, okay? And this is something which is actually used in many settings that I will allow you to repack things as long as you don't disturb the system too often, okay? And that's exactly what I want to understand, okay? So let me pose one of the concrete questions so that it's clear what we are studying. So suppose I say that, suppose whenever a new item arrives, I allow you to take one existing item somewhere and move it somewhere else, okay? All right? And the question is, what can we prove? We can prove that if you allow me just this small amount of flexibility, even when items are moving out, you can get 38%. You will be only 38% worse off, okay? So you can prove this much competitive ratio. And you can also show that nobody can do better, okay? So there's no gap here as such. Okay? You can also meet this lower bound, okay? So in that sense, we prove the optimal possible fact here, okay? So I will just get into one sort of, you know, main technical aspect here, just explain to you how this, what is the main idea, and not get into any of the details, and then move on. So one reason, let's go back to this idea that, you know, you're doing some sort of first fit kind of thing. So let's say initially a lot of tiny items arrive, and you pack them in the first two bins like this, okay? And then somewhat large items arrive, and you have to pack them like that, okay? And somebody who knew the future, you know, now of course I'm allowing you to repack things. I'm allowing you to, you know, every item can be moved, let's say, once. So you now say that if you're giving me this flexibility, maybe I know that they can be packed like this. So maybe I'll move all of these and move them like this. Okay? And this is the best possible way of packing them. So instead of using six bins, you can use four bins. And now you can do this because you can move each item once. Okay? But now suppose that all these four items disappear. Okay? Then you realize that this is bad. I should move back to this configuration where there are only two bins, okay? So then you want to go back here. But this can happen many times, okay? So that's why just this idea of using a first fit kind of algorithm and, you know, whenever things go bad, just fixing thing does not work, okay? So what really works, you know, I'm doing this in a very brief way, is that you figure out that you're going to leave some space, okay? So whenever even these small items arrive, what you're going to say is that some of the bins, I will not deliberately fill them to the complete extent. Okay, I leave out some space in some of the bins. And this is to sort of anticipate for what will happen in the future. Okay? And the main sort of idea is that how do you figure out how much to leave out in every bin? Okay? Do you leave out 50% space? Do you leave out 70% space? You don't know what will happen in the future. Okay? So basically, you know, you build some sort of distribution like this. Okay? You say that, you know, some alpha fraction of the bins will be 70% empty. Some beta fraction of the bins will be 90% empty. This again, given the situation that all these are tiny items. So that if a big item arrives, they can fit in one of these things. Okay? And turns out that you can discover this sort of distribution by writing a suitable linear program. Okay? So I will not get into that. And so that's the main sort of interesting thing about the algorithm. Okay? This algorithm, I will not say that. You can extend this model to many settings. You can extend it to models where, you know, different items have different sizes. So they're all not equivalent. Moving them costs different amount of money. Okay? People can also ask, you know, what happens if these are not 1D things, but these are 2D things, 3D things. These again active areas of research. So that's what I wanted to talk about. These are all called packing problems. Let me just mention one other class of problems. These are called covering problems. These are again something which arise very often in practice. So this is again one of the most well-studied problems in computer science. Anybody who has done theoretical computer science would know, or anybody in computer science will know about this problem. It's called a set cover problem. Again, problem is very natural. It says the following, that I give you some set of points, okay? Think of these black things as points. And what you're given are some sort of sets, okay? So each of these disks is a set, which contains a subset of these points, okay? And so think of this as, you know, just these geometric objects, okay? And what you want to do is you want to find the smallest number of these disks which cover all the points, okay? And again, you know, there are lots of applications where these could be potential sort of demands, and these could be some sort of resources that you can service these demands with, okay? So you want to use as few resources as possible, and so this is a very natural thing, okay? And again, for example, here, if you pick this disk, and this disk, they will cover everything, okay? And again, the online problem is that, you know, instead of thinking of it like this, these points are arriving one by one. You don't know what which points will arrive, okay? So at some point, you know, you see, let's say, this yellow point, okay? That's the only point you see. So then you will say that I will pick the pink set. But at some other point, let's say some more point arrives. Let's say that yellow point arrives. You'll say, I'm fine, I'm still covering it. But at some other point, some other yellow point arrives, so you add one more set to your solution, and so on. Okay? So the problem is that you don't know what the entire set of points will be. So as points arrive, you kind of build up your solution. Okay? So at each time a point arrives or an existing point departs, and you have to maintain these, figure out what these disks are which will cover all these points. So again, the model is exactly the same like last time, that whenever a point arrives or departs, you're allowed to maintain a set of disks, and at each time you can add one more disk or you can remove an existing disk from your solution. Okay? And the question is again, what can you prove here? Okay? And right, so for example, okay. So let's say at some point of time you have these two solutions, a new point arrives, then you remove this solution, you add that disk. Okay, so again, there's a lot of interesting theoretical work which has happened here. For example, you know, what is known, something I will not prove here, is that what is called something called greedy algorithm, that is shown to be log n approximation. What that means is that if the optimum were 10 sets, you will be using 10 times log of n sets. Okay, and this is the best possible. Okay, and in the online set cover, where you don't know the entire future, it turns out that you have to have an additional factor of log m, where m is the number of sets. Okay, so you will have to incur this much loss no matter what happens, right? And we have shown that again, you can basically get as good as the offline problem in this model. Okay, so this is our result, which basically matches the known results for the setting where you kind of knew the future also. Okay, so I'll just conclude with what future directions are here. So basically the main idea is that you kind of understand this interplay between the fact that you don't know the future and the fact that you can make some changes in your solution. Okay. So how much can you disturb your existing solution, and how does that play with the fact that you don't know the future? Okay. So bin packing, a set cover I talked about, there are a host bunch of problems, something called in graph theory, a lot of people study a lot of these problems. Load balancing, network flows, facility location, where you're trying to locate facilities so they cater to the demands. Again, it's a huge area of research. And again, these models have been studied there. Okay. So, and again, extension to many other problems remains an interesting direction. Thanks.